Welcome again, maybe, to this session on Spring Framework 4 on Java 8. Let me maybe clarify a little on what the focus of this particular session is. We have covered, for a start, in the early Java 8 support, even last year, at last year's Spring 1, several other occasions. We have plenty of Java 8 coverage at this conference in some form. We are already post JDK 8 GA now. I mean, last year it was about early JDK 8 support. This year it's about Java 8 runtime support, natural Java 8 support in practice. You're going to see, or maybe you probably have seen, code examples on Java 8 already without them being qualified as such necessarily. Java 8 in the meantime, from our perspective, is a natural part of what we're working with and what we find in production already, to some degree at least. So Java 8, just like Groovy, just naturally shows up in many of our code examples and many of our demos at this show. In this particular session, I'd like to give you a bit of a background view. So it's not so much about, you know, using Java 8 in demo X or Y. It's more a background perspective on why are we doing this? How are we doing this? Some of the Java 8 features that you may not be as aware of. It's not just about lambdas. There's quite a bit more than that. And it's an opportunity to give you a very up-to-date view. So it's actually Spring Framework 4.1 on Java 8. I'll give you just a couple of very recent developments as well. The examples on specific Java 8 features that have only been introduced in the Spring Framework 4.1 generation. If we get to it, and I suppose we will, then I'll also take the opportunity to illustrate a few related features, such as the support for the standard priority annotation and a few related ones. So it's not all just about Java 8. In the session, you're going to see and learn about quite a bit of functionality that has a kind of connection to Java 8. That's a natural part of that story, but not actually Java 8 specific. So even if you're not using Java 8 in practice yet or cannot use it in production for a further while, I hope there's some interesting stuff in this session that you maybe can translate to your current deployment environments, even if not running on Java 8 as well. All right, so much for the focus. For a start, since there are not that many opportunities at this conference to actually recap the Spring Framework 4.1 arrangement, I'll take this opportunity to just quickly summarize what this is, where we're at. Spring Framework 4, for us, is primarily a baseline. Even if we're talking about Java 8 here, Java 8 support, of course, is a key part of the Spring Framework 4 story, but the baseline is actually Java 6. As I'm sure all of you are aware, we have a pretty solid track record of backwards compatibility with all the JDKs. The current plan is that the Spring Framework 4 line, of course 4.1, the plan 4.2, are all on the same baseline, still Java 6 and 7 compatible, of course, even if we see more and more use of Spring 4 on Java 8 these days. The baseline is also on the EE side. It's kind of an EE6 baseline with a specific compromise. I'm just pointing it out at every single opportunity here that the Spring 4 generation is Servlet 2.5 compatible at runtime. It can run on a Servlet 2.5 container, in particular on Google App Engine, in particular on WebSphere 7. You can even run Tomcat 6 with this, of course, also a Servlet 2.5 container. You can even run Tomcat 6 on Java 8 if you'd like. I wouldn't exactly recommend that, but there are good reasons why we are going to preserve our Servlet 2.5 compatibility for a while. The Java 8 part, of course, is the focus of this session, but it's also about Java E7. We extended our compatibility spectrum to Java E7. And there's quite a bit of stuff both in the Spring 4.0 and Spring 4.1 generations that goes into support for specific features from that specification generation. JMS 2.0 is a good example. JPA 2.1 is very commonly used, Hibernate 4.3. bean validation 1.1 translates to Hibernate Validator 5, commonly used with Spring 4 as well, and JSR-236 concurrency, starting to see some use like on Wildfly, for example. So it's about, as always with Spring, it's about support for each individual specification here. The umbrella, the E7 umbrella, doesn't have much practical relevance for Spring at this point. There are hardly any Java E7 servers. There's only really Glassfish and Wildfly as complete E7 platforms. It's more important actually to support those individually as you run into providers implementing those specs like Hibernate ORM, Hibernate Validator, Hornet Q as a broker, GMS2O broker, for example. So those have, of course, a role and are showing up at this conference in several places. Here's a recap of the features themes in Spring 4.0. And a little bit of that is going to shine through in the course of this presentation. Remember, of course, Spring Framework 4.0 is the foundation for Spring Boot. So, for example, the conditional bean definition model is primarily there for Spring Boot to consume it, to take it to yet another level. But there are a couple of other ones. Our composable annotation model is pretty popular and has a few nice twists with overwritable attributes in Spring Framework 4. There's the whole story about the messaging module that I've been covering in my previous session today. And our WebSocket support. The entirety of our WebSocket support has been introduced in the Spring Framework 4.0 line. So there's a lot of work in the 4.0 generation. It's not just about Java 8. And there's also injection matching by generic type. If we have enough time, I'm going to get back to that at the very end of the presentation. It fits nicely into the flow. In 4.1, we take Spring Framework 4.0 as it is. We continue on some of the themes in there, also on the Java 8 theme, on the WebSocket theme. We have a strong MVC focus. You're seeing a lot of MVC features, and they're being covered here in dedicated sessions at this conference. There's, of course, the JCache and annotated JMS listener stuff from my previous session as well. So Spring Framework 4.0 and 4.1 are really some of the most feature-rich releases we've done in a number of years here, and all coming within just about 9 months. All right, so much for a little bit of a broader view on what those releases have to offer. In our Java 8 perspective here, there's quite a bit of stuff we're going to cover in the course of this session. There's, of course, lambda expressions. Method references is a variant thereof, and I'm going to get to how those two relate. There's JSR-310, the java.time package. Actually, a really important piece to have in the standard JDK these days. There's repeatable annotations. There's the parameter name discovery model, one of the things never mentioned in standard Java 8 presentations, but actually pretty important, a pretty important enabler from our perspective, and a really good fit for the programming model needs that Spring has. And there's Java util optional as a standard Java 8 type that's commonly showing up in Java 8 APIs, in the collection stream APIs, for example. We're also supporting use of it in your code, in your Spring-based code these days. We're also going to cover that. And a couple of related injection features that are not immediately Java 8-based, at priority actually, is defined in the common annotation specification. That's the JSR-250 line, version 1.2. So it's in the Java X annotation package. It's going to end up in the JDK at some point, but it didn't make JDK 8, despite being available. But it's nice to have, can nicely be added. So I'm going to cover a few injection features towards the end, simply because they are actually pretty interesting to reason about. And it also nicely explains how we are approaching this whole support of newer JDK generations and newer common annotation generations. All right. Let's start with lambdas. It's, of course, the the big feature, right, in Java 8. It's the one that's being talked about all the time. Lambdas are basically a quite simple convention where the JDK compiler, the JDK 8 compiler, is able to apply a lambda expression of yours to a target API call, automatically adapting this lambda expression to the signature of the target call. It's not a standalone kind of function mechanism. It's actually just a compiler feature. It's the compiler understanding how to apply such a kind of functional expression in the context of an API call, in the context of a method call, of applying this lambda to a target method parameter. Typical examples would be runnable, callable, those kinds of pretty straightforward single method callback interfaces. And they're used, for example, with a standard JDK executor. You call execute, you pass in a runnable, or you call submit, pass in a callable. For those kinds of scenarios, exactly those kinds of invocation scenarios, that's where lambdas have been made for. And in rich lambda-oriented APIs, you would not just pass in a single callback, you can pass in a whole sequence, a whole chain of such callback specifications, as in the collection stream API. JDK 8 comes with a number of common functional interfaces. So it's not just about the convention itself. They are actually heavily using it within the standard Java APIs as well. Java util function has stuff like function predicate supply and quite a few others. Common, simple, straightforward callback interfaces. And they are heavily used in the collection stream API itself. And in other places. They are also used, like there's consumer, for example, used in Java util optional. They really show up in many places. Those callback interfaces are supposed to be a common ground between APIs to talk to for several kind of newer Java 8 style APIs, Java 8 based APIs, to interact with each other through common types. So Java 8 has a lot to offer. It's primarily a compiler feature, but that compiler feature is kind of a design influence, and it's showing in the JDK itself, in particular in the new Java 8 collection stream API. So it's a combination of a compiler feature, a kind of language design convention, API design convention, and it's even used already in the JDK itself. In the Spring world, from a Spring perspective, we have plenty of such scenarios. The convention behind Java 8 lambda expressions is basically the same that we've been using for our template callback model ever since 2003. So it's actually a pretty old convention that we've been using in the Spring world. We had our transaction template with a transaction callback as a pretty generic kind of version of this. You create your transaction template, configure it with a transaction manager, then you call do in transaction, then you call execute, you pass in a transaction callback implementation, and the transaction callback gets a do in transaction callback, and you perform your work within the context of this transaction. A pretty simple callback scenario. You call execute and pass in a larger callback. That callback is going to be run within the context of a transaction. A very typical scenario that's immediately applicable to lambdas. Any such arrangement, any such invocation arrangement, is just a natural Java 8 lambda target. Not because we've applied any special measures to these APIs. It's just by convention. The convention that the JDK 8 compiler happens to use for lambda expressions is just the same convention that we've been using for more than 10 years here. That's actually a great fit. I mean, it's a nice example that even with a decade in between, API design conventions can actually nicely match. JDBC templates, as the example that we're going to use in the next few slides, JDBC template has plenty of those callbacks. It has prepared statement setter, it has connection callback, it has results that extractor, it has a row mapper, row callback handler. It has plenty of callback APIs that are all natural Lambda candidates. The two important ones that we're going to use here are the prepared statement set and the row mapper. So prepared statement set is an interface with a callback method called set values. You get access to a prepared statement at the right time. That's the point of callbacks. You're going to be invoked at the right time of processing. The prepared statement is being passed to your code. You're supposed to set some parameters on it. And at the later point of processing, the JDBC template is going to invoke a row mapper if you specified one. The row mapper gets a callback map row for each row in a result set. So it's actually invoked once per result set row. And you get access to the current result set, properly set to the current row, and to the current row number. Those are the two parameters passed into that callback. So it's a two-parameter callback, not a single-parameter callback. Both of them are declared to throw SQL exception simply because any kind of JDBC API throws SQL exception. So it's meant to be passed through. You're not supposed to throw your own, of course. But it's important because the JDK 8 lambda benefits are in particular in that domain. You don't have to redeclare exceptions. All right. In the nicest possible version, the most concise version, a JDBC template call with a prepared statement setter and a row mapper would look like here. This is a standard JDBC template call. The query method that we're invoking here takes a string, the SQL string, a prepared statement setter, and a row mapper. So it's three arguments, of course, each in a line here. The SQL string is simple. The second line is a prepared statement setter implementation. And the third line is a row mapper implementation, specified in line within the method call. So this PS set string is a lambda expression that the compiler, a compiler understands that this lambda is being applied to a target query call. At this position, at this parameter position, the compiler understands that there's a prepared statement setter expected. So the compiler takes this lambda expression, compiles it, coerces it into a prepared statement setter, and passes the prepared statement setter into the query call. This happens just through specifying the lambda here. In the shortest possible version, all you do is you refer to the incoming parameters. Remember, prepared statement setter has a prepared statement PS here in the middle of the slide. So this is the incoming parameter to the prepared statement setter. All you do here is you refer to that parameter and bind it to a lambda expression. This is the inline lambda expression style without code blocks. So there's no need to have a full Java statement here. No need for a semicolon at the end in particular. Assuming that it's only a single statement to make. If you want to set several parameters, you'll have to use the style that we'll see next. In the row mapper line, the third line here, we do the same kind of thing, but we have two parameters coming in. It's the result set and the row number. So we'll have to declare both of those parameters, bind them to a lambda that says create a new person instance from my incoming result set. I'm going to grab two values from that result set, passing them into the person constructor. And I'm going to return that new person object from my row mapper implementation. But you're not expressing this here. There is no need for a return statement. In this lambda expression style, if you coerce this lambda, if you apply it to a target callback interface, which happens to return an object, then the return statement is implicit, which is really nice for this inline style. So no return keyword, no semicolon at the end of this substatement. Right, so that's the shortest possible version. It's actually a great example for the applicability of lambdas. If all you do is apply a single lambda expression instead of, say, an anonymous inner class, then it's kind of nice. But the moment that you have more than one lambda in a single method call, this becomes really compelling. So it's in particular compelling if there's more than one lambda involved in a single method call or in a chain of method calls. Right, talking about anonymous inner classes. That's of course what you would do if you don't have lambdas available to you. What you would typically do is you take those interfaces, you have a anonymous or named inner class that implements prepared statement setter or row mapper, and you pass that thing into the query call. It becomes a little unpleasant. It wouldn't even properly fit on that slide if we had two anonymous inner classes here, because you have to redeclare the method signature and the throws clauses, and there's a lot of kind of craft around it. Whereas these lambdas here are really focused on the actual callback implementation. There's hardly any syntactic overhead. In particular, no throws clauses, no redeclared method bodies, not even the names of the callback methods. The names of the callback methods would be set values and map road, but they don't show up here. It's really focused on the actual body of the callback implementation. In a slightly different syntactic arrangement, you could express it like this. Instead of the lambda expression style, you could use the code block style, a regular Java code block as a target of a lambda. It's very similar. It's really just replacing the target expression with a full Java code block within code block brackets. A Java code block needs to follow Java statement rules. So here we have ps set string blah, 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 with a semicolon at the end. If you have more than one statement, no problem, just put it into that code block. The code block forms the body of the callback implementation. In the row mapper, in the third argument here, it's basically the same kind of game. Again, the code block. You could do some calculations ahead of the return statement. So it could be several statements in there. But even with this single statement here, it looks nice enough, and it's maybe a bit of a friendly layout, a layout that is friendlier to the traditional Java eye. This may look a little alien to a, say, standard Java-minded, Java-trained developer eye. This may be a little more acceptable to some. In any case, the row mapper down here is a Java code block. A Java code block, of course, needs to have a return statement if it's returning something. So there's a return statement, semicolon, at the end. So these are basically the two lambda styles. Let me add that parameter declarations here can be qualified with a type. So you can say prepared statement PS here. You can say results at RS int row num. You could do that here too, but you don't have to. And typically you wouldn't do it, because the actual types are strongly declared in the target call anyway. If you know which interface it is being bound to, there's no need for the compiler to know about those, unless you have a ambiguity with kind of overloaded methods and different kinds of callback interfaces, in which cases it may help. If you add them, you primarily do it for yourself to see the type here in those calls, but again, you don't have to. This is basically the Java 8 lambda feature in the compiler. There's not much more to it. There's the two variants, expression style, code block style. There's the declarations of the parameters, single parameter, multiple parameters with the brackets around them. And you can add type declarations to the parameters. This is basically it. That's a basically complete definition of the Java 8 lambda rules. That's a really good thing to be able to say. In contrast to Java 5 generics, this is not the best 1%, and I'm kind of hiding the ugly 99% underneath the carpet here. This is the feature. It's as simple as that. It's very straightforward, easy enough to understand. You just need to get used to that syntax, basically to those syntax variants. That's it. Immediately applicable as long as the convention applies, as long as you're actually trying to use it against a target call that has appropriate parameter types, appropriate callback interfaces as parameter types. So that's as great as a language feature can be designed from my perspective in the Java world. It's immediately applicable to existing APIs as long as those existing APIs follow the same conventions. And it's immediately applicable to Spring's JDBC template as seen here, without special measures in JDBC template. I will admit at this point that us being aware of that language feature has been an influence on some of our API design. So in some of our newer interfaces, such as Listenable Future, have been influenced by the availability of this language feature. So you would maybe decompose a callback that naturally has two methods. You would decompose it into two callback interfaces with one method each, because then it can be used with a lambda expression. That's a typical case where you would not be able to apply it otherwise. So if you have a target interface with several callback methods in there, even with just two, the compiler won't accept it because it's unclear which of those methods you bind the lambda to. That only applies if both of those methods are abstract, in the sense of if they don't have a default implementation. Since in Java 8, interface methods can have default implementations. Strictly speaking, the Java 8 compiler rules for lambdas are there needs to be one non-default, exactly one non-default method in the target interface. There can be others with default implementation. That's all right. The compiler is then going to select the one that doesn't have a default implementation. It's worth knowing for newer interfaces. And it's worth knowing when you're trying to understand the JDK's own use of lambdas against collections, against some of the Java util function types. All right, that's lambdas. There are method references. Method references are a kind of variant of lambdas in Java 8. And are typically used in places where you would otherwise use a lambda. So let's look at this JDBC template query call. It's the same call. It's in the context of some repository method here, basically just to have a frame for it. It's not really important. You create the JDBC template instance. You pass in the SQL statement. You pass in a regular prepared statement lambda. So that's a regular lambda, as we've seen it before. This one here is, well, bound to the row mapper argument of the query call. It's a method reference to a method that the compiler is going to coerce into a row mapper. So it's just like with lambdas, it's a compiler feature. The compiler understands the method reference as, okay, this code is pointing to this method by a compiler understood reference. We're not using a reflection, this is not a string, it's the actual method name in the source code. And that target method, in terms of its signature, needs to be compatible with the target interface that you're trying to bind it to, that you're trying to coerce it into. So it's no coincidence that this map person method, in terms of its signature, looks like a row mapper. Since row mapper looks like this, right? Return some object, actually generically typed, but doesn't matter. Result set, row num, throw a SQL exception. This mapperson method looks just like a row mapper method implementation because that's what it's supposed to be. But it does not have to implement row mapper. It's a method, right? It can't implement an interface. But it follows the convention of that row mapper declared mapper method. So it takes person, does the same stuff, has to declare SQL exception. It's a standard Java method. No special rules applying here. If rsGetString throws a SQL exception, you have to redeclare SQL exception here. And with the this colon colon map person up there, you tell the compiler, like, please try to coerce this to a row mapper. That's exactly what the compiler will do. There's no use of a reflective proxy here, no invocation handler. It's a very efficient representation of what you're saying here. If you compile this, the compiler will use invoke dynamic to basically to perform a direct invocation of this target map person method whenever the call comes into the coerced row mapper. It's a very efficient representation. It's slightly more efficient than anonymous inner classes would be even, because you're not creating an instance of an anonymous inner class. You're directly dispatching to this map person method. So lambdas and method references are kind of variants of the same thing, different sides of the same coin. Because what does the compiler do when you try to compile such use of lambdas? Well, it will take the method body of the first lambda, put it into a synthetic generated method called like lambda $0. If I get the naming, the naming right there, it's completely internal, so that the compiler generates that into the class file, but it can be seen in the class file. It takes the method body, puts it in there, takes the second lambda, the row mapper lambda, creates another lambda $1, puts the method body in there, and then coerces it to prepared statement or row mapper, depending on the argument, and directly dispatches to those generated methods. Effectively, what the JDK compiler does, it takes this code and turns it into basically this code. It takes those lambdas, factors them out into generated methods, just like this method here, but completely synthetic. You're not seeing them in the source code. They're just in the bytecode. And then it dispatches to that method. The same style as it dispatches with a method reference. Basically, converts this lambda into a method reference to a generated method. It does not create anonymous inner classes at this point. It does not create classes from this. It creates methods and dispatches to those methods very efficiently. Right, with method references here, you can, of course, reference static methods by specifying the class, :, method name. This basically says, of course, on our current instance, so you can refer to any method. Whether static or non-static does not make a difference, as long as the method itself is signature compatible to the target interface, all is good. Those are basically method references. This feature can easily be underestimated. There's a lot that you can do with that feature. You can, for example, create a collection of mapping methods, like 10 of those map. Whatever map person, map order, map event, and put all of them into the same method. And in your repositories, you can reuse them by pointing to them through a method reference in an external class, not inline. Not private methods, public methods on an external class meant for reuse, and pointed to by a method reference. So there's some really nice stuff. If you ever dive into the Java 8 collection stream APIs, you're also going to see some use of method references for filtering, for sorting. They are basically pointing to predefined methods that can easily be coerced into consumers and predicates, since some of those just naturally fit. You can consumer and predicate, those interfaces are really simple if they don't even have arguments. You can bind them to like string is empty or those sorts of methods, string to uppercase. Those can be targets of method references, as long as what you're trying to bind them to is compatible in terms of signature, and many of those interfaces naturally are. Right. That's basically method references. They're syntactically, that's an almost complete definition. There's not much more to the actual compiler feature, to the actual language feature. The rest of the story, and there's many, many stories to be told around this still, but the rest of this comes through the use of method references and lambdas in practice. In your code, in some of the API design of common libraries that kind of naturally suggest the use of lambdas or method references. That's great from from the balance between the complexity of the language feature versus the impact in real life. That's almost perfect. Very simple, straightforward language features that can be explained in a few minutes, and a lot of practical use, a lot of creativity in practical use of this. That's going to take years until we all fully grasp what those language features mean, what impact they have onto our everyday code. All right, so much for lambdas and method references for a start. Java 8 is not just about lambdas and method references, so let's cover a few other things as well. JSR-310, the date and time API, is, an initiative that has been out there for quite a while. The spec lead of JSR-310, Stephen Colburn, is the same guy that also created the Chodo Time project. So you're going to see quite a bit of similarity here. However, it's not just Chodo Time in the JDK. it's actually a kind of rethinking of JODA time, a re-architecture of JODA time found in the java.time package in the JDK now. The common data types are very similar to JODA time. So local date, local date time, local time, zoned date time have immediate immediate equivalents in JODA time. But in terms of the processing APIs, some of the naming conventions for the methods and so forth, you're going to find significant differences between JODA time and JSR-310. So it's not a one-to-one comparison where you can just switch the imports. For the data types, that may work, but not if you have more complex logic on those types, against those types. Anyway, the most important part is the data types. We have a customer here, a domain object, any domain object, which happens to have some natural fields expressed as a date or a timestamp or whatever it is. What could you do without the use of JSR-310 and without the use of JODA time? Well, you would have to dump them down to Java util date or Java util calendar types. You would say private date birth date, private date last contact. And the type itself wouldn't express at all what specific kind of date or time type you mean. Is it just the date? Is it a timestamp within a day? Is it meant to be applicable within a specific zone or a relative to the zone? Or is it a hard timestamp against the 1st of January 1970? The type itself wouldn't express that. It's trying to be all of those things. That's the main problem with Java util date and its mutability. But the lack of expressiveness is the biggest issue. The specific types that we're using here are saying have a very specific meaning, a very specific semantics attached to them. Local date basically means, yes, this on this date, doesn't matter which time zone, I'm just translating that, adapting that to each of the time zones, it's equally applicable in any zone. Local date time does that with the date plus local time. A zoned date time is rather a fixed timestamp, like for a meeting. It happens at a specific day, specific time, within a specific zone. It needs to be translated to other time zones for the very same timestamp. So plenty of other such types. There's also instant, for example, to represent the kind of milliseconds since 1970 semantic. So there, for each of those specific kinds of date and time types, there is a appropriate class, a corresponding class in the java.time package. And within our domain classes, we can use the most appropriate type. We can select a type that accurately reflects the meaning of our field, the semantics of the field that we're modeling here. So that's local date time, zone date time, and so forth. And what we do in Spring Framework 4, if we bind to those fields, or if we render them out, Spring naturally understands those types. It auto-detects the presence of the java.time package and automatically adapts to those types, uses the appropriate APIs to convert into them and to render them out. Spring already comes with an @datetime format annotation since Spring 3.0. And that datetime format can also be used here. It can be used with regular Java util date types as well, but here it can sit next to a JSR-310 datetime type and add a specific parsing and rendering format. So you could, like down here, it's a pattern where you're saying like this last contact field, if it happens to be bound, if an incoming string happens to be bound to it, or if it's being rendered out to a textual format without further configuration, then please use this pattern by default. That's what you're saying with that annotation. In our birth date case above, you can also use @datetime format and say like, in this case, I want the standard ISO date representation for a date, not datetime, when binding to it or when formatting it, when rendering it out. However, you don't have to do that. That's why it's commented out. You're basically repeating yourself because you're already saying in the actual type of the field, you're already saying this is a local date. Local date is expressive enough for Spring to derive some default binding and formatting rules from it. And that's exactly what the annotation would say. We are using the ISO date format for date binding. So basically, you can drop that line. There's no need to add a datetime format to it if the type itself is expressive enough and you're happy with the default conventions for that specific type. But that's really nice. The field itself becomes more expressive. Additional annotations can just go away in some cases. The same story applies to JSR-310, fundamentally. So if you're not on Java 8, cannot be on Java 8 in a while, try to use JSR-310 the same way. Spring supports JSR-310 the same way. You have to import the types from org.JSR-310. The types are basically same named. The binding and formatting logic comes with Spring. You won't notice much of the difference there in the API because you're just using the types themselves. There's not as much difference there in the types. And the @datetime format argument here applies to JSR-310 as well. So also with JSR-310, we can get rid of this first @datetime format line there because the JSR-310 local date type, of course, is also expressive enough. It is, if it's a pattern, of course, we're using the pattern, but as much as a locale is needed for the default convention, ever since Spring 3.0, there's a datetime context that we're using, which can be used for the specific settings, and there's a locale context that we can populate for the general purposes. So there's infrastructure in Spring where the stuff is being set for you as long as we can properly derive it. So in a Spring MVC context, dispatcher servlet is going to populate the locale context with the current request locale. Actually, the locale that comes from the locale resolver. If you happen to be in a different kind of invocation path, there's a locale context holder where you can just call set locale on it. You can set both the regular locale, the regular country language settings, and additional context as far as you have it, such as the time zone. So you can also set the time zone because, strictly speaking, the conversion, the formatting and binding is dependent on both the locale, the country and language settings, and the time zone. Depends on the specific type, but it can be. And both of those are managed as thread locals by the Spring infrastructure, auto-populated as far as we can. If not, you can basically do your own try, catch block, set the locale context, reset it at the end of the block in unit tests or in any kind of invocations that come from an external context where you can derive that information and where Spring cannot do it automatically for you. Applies both to JSR-310 and to JSR-310 again, and to Java util date parsing. So Spring uses that same thread local context for any such purposes. Also for a message resolution against the resource bundle, and it's generally a good idea to set that context if you have it. Right. Different topic. Annotation applicability in your source code. In Java 8, there's a possibility opened up that wasn't there before, because you can repeat the very same annotation type against the same method field constructor, etc. Now, the example above didn't actually work in Java 7. So the Java 7 compiler would reject use of the very same annotation type several times against the same method. In the best you can do in Java 6 or 7 is this here. You would have to have a kind of outer container annotation that has an array of nested @scheduled annotations. That would work. That does work, actually. So that's what we do support on Java 6 and 7. It's new in Spring 4, but it's Java 6, 7 compatible. On Java 8, you can do this. You just put repeated @scheduled annotations there with different cron triggers, for example. If any of those triggers fires, Spring is going to invoke, and the backend configuration is set up, then Spring would invoke that callback method if any of those triggers fires. So that works on Java 8, and it naturally works. So if you're on Java 8, you can just do this, compile it, Spring's going to detect it. On Java 6 or 7, the compiler is going to complain about that. You're going to have to resort to that style. So that's repeatable annotations. We, from a framework perspective, we have to declare our annotations accordingly. This does not just work against any annotation. Annotations, the annotation types that are supposed to be usable like that, have to be declared as @repeatable, meta-annotated. So the our definition of @scheduled is meta-annotated with @repeatable. The compiler underneath the covers actually generates this for you. So whenever you do this, the JDK 8 compiler generates this. And from a reflection perspective, when you're trying to look at the Java lang reflect method handle and trying to look at the annotations associated with it, this is what you're going to see. You're going to see the container annotation. So we have to declare that accordingly. We're doing that as of Spring Framework 4. Thanks to the JVM rules for loading non-present annotation types, our same @scheduled annotation can be used on JDK 6, 7, and 8 because it's always marked as @repeatable, and @repeatable is a JDK 8 annotation. But on JDK 6 or 7, the JVM is smart enough to understand that that annotation on that @scheduled annotation, that meta annotation, is simply not present on the class path. So it's going to ignore it, silently drop it. So that's one of the little tricks that we are using, how the very same, how we can achieve the goal that the very same Spring Framework 4 jars that we deliver to you, the very same set of jars, works on Java 6, 7, and 8. It does unlock all those Java 8 features if you're on Java 8, and the very same jars, the very same classes, perfectly well adapt to Java 6 or 7 when used there. So there are a couple of those tricks that we're using underneath the covers. And yeah, repeatable annotations are nice. @scheduled is a good example. @property source on configuration classes, specifying several property sources on the same configuration class is a good example as well. Can also be used that way. In principle, yes. It's a good question. Does this apply to other annotations, right? Are they declared accordingly? In principle, yes. In practice, not yet. Because only in JPA 2.2 or whatever it will be, that's actually Java 8 based, then they're going to do that. So I'm afraid that many of the existing annotations out there cannot be used like that yet. And I'm not sure that specs are going to use that little trick that we're using with the non-loadable repeatable annotations. So we probably have to wait for those specs to actually go Java 8 plus. That's going to take a few years. But annotations that we control, and I'm sure some annotations in some other open source projects at some point will be able to be used like that. You'll be able to use them in the above style. Okay, parameter name discovery, as mentioned before, is one of the little hidden gems in JDK 8. For a long, long, long time in the Java world, parameter names did not have significance in the bytecode. Both with method parameters and with constructor parameters, the compiler is going to swallow the parameter names, and in the bytecode, all you have is a method or constructor signature with a list of parameter types, no names. As of JDK 8, that's still the case by default. Let me add, unfortunately, but you can add a dash parameters flag to your Java C call, to your compilation flags. And with dash parameters, the JDK 8 compiler is going to add a dedicated section to your class file, a little parameter name section for each method, where all of those names are being preserved. And Java 8 has reflection methods, like on Java lang reflect methods, on class, on field, where you can ask it, not on field, method and on constructor, of course, in this particular case. There are quite a few new reflection methods, but those particular ones are, of course, to be found on constructor and method, where you can ask for parameter names. Just like you can say method get parameter types, you can also say method get parameter names. only resolvable, of course, if you did compile with fresh parameters. Otherwise, you get fake parameters back. Arg0, arg1, arg2. So you're always going to get something back from that call against the JDK. But the way that Spring interprets these calls is a little different, because technically speaking, it's not get parameter names, it's get parameters, and you call get name on each of the parameter objects. But there's also an isParam present, so Spring actually finds out for you whether the parameter is specified in the actual source code, if it's been preserved from your source code, or whether it's been faked by the JDK runtime. So in Spring, parameter name discovery strictly follows the rules that parameter names only have significance if they come from your source code. We never react to generated parameter names. This mechanism isn't new. The same kind of style of parameter name resolution has been out there for a while, where we've been using an implementation, a strategy that goes into the class files, reads the debug symbols section via ASM, and parses the parameter names from the debug symbol section. So that's what you can do, still can do, on Java 6 and 7. You can even do it on Java 8 if you, for some reason, don't want to compile with dash parameters. For the debug symbol strategy to work out, you need to compile with dash debug. So on of course, if you're on JDK 8, I would strongly recommend to use dash parameters. But if you're on 6 or 7, or for some reason can't use dash parameters on 8, then you can always compile with dash debug. Dash debug takes your class, and for each implemented method and constructor, for each constructor and method with a body, it's going to add a debug symbol section. And the debugger wants to know which of the arguments, which name it has, right? He wants to associate names to parameters. So the parameter names are to be found in there. And Spring can read them from there. Only for methods with a body. That's a slight advantage of dash parameters. It actually preserves the parameters for abstract methods as well, even if they are not needed as much for abstract methods. Of course, they are being preserved there. Spring generally only really needs them for implementation methods, such as, in this case, that's parameter name discovery in action. For example, a Spring MVC handler method, taking a number of arguments, like a long ID and a string country, and the way that we are adding semantics to those declared parameters is parameter level annotations. So we're saying at path variable, long ID. This long ID parameter refers to a path variable of the same name declared in the mapped path. And request header refers to a header, an HTTP header named country, just like the parameter name. For that to actually work in practice, we need parameter name discovery, because those parameter names here have significance. We want to know what the name of this parameter is. We need to correlate it with the declared path variable names. We need to know the name of that country parameter here, because there can be any request headers associated with the HTTP header. If you don't want those names to have significance, which translates to if you don't want to compile with dash parameters or dash debug, then you can declare specific names here. You can say add path variable and declare the name ID as an annotation attribute. Same for add request header, same for add request param, same for add cookie value. But it's, of course, nicer, at least from my perspective, it's nicer if you don't have to repeat that name. If you just declare a single name, that name matches the actual path variable, actual request header name. If the name differs, that's one way of getting around it, is to declare the actual target name here. Anyway, for this to work out, you need parameter name discovery, that background mechanism. It happens automatically. You don't need to activate it. You don't need to configure it. All you need to do is compile with dash parameters on Java 8 or with dash debug on Java 6 or 7. And Spring auto detects the names for you. If you happen to run such code, if dispatcher server happens to encounter such code in a scenario where the parameter names are not resolvable, So where you did not compile with hash parameters, did not compile with hash debug, or for some other reason we can't parse the parameter names, if it ever runs into that, you're going to get an exception, because the parameter names do have significance here. And Spring's runtime infrastructure understands that they are significant. So it's not going to fall back or guess the parameter names or anything. If they are not properly resolvable, you're going to get an exception. All right, that's parameter name discovery. In Spring MVC handler methods, in Spring 4.1 also, for example, in JMS endpoint methods, annotated JMS endpoint methods, in WebSocket, stomp processing methods, in many kinds of endpoint methods in Spring, those parameter names have significance. And even in the dependency injection world, there's a little feature named constructor parameters where the parameter names also have significance. Where if you have an XML file that says like, here's a bean, here's a constructor arc, and you refer to the constructor arc by name. That only works if at runtime we can actually understand the constructor parameter names. Requires the same mechanism underneath the covers. So there's quite a bit of this stuff. It's not just about MVC handler methods. In quite a few corners of the framework, parameter names can have significance. They never have to have significance, but it's always convenient. In all of those places, it's more convenient if you can rely on the parameter names. Right, so much for parameter name discovery. While we're at it, let's take this example a little bit further and check the time for a moment. So, in MVC handler methods, as we've just seen one, there are plenty of parameters that can have optional characteristics associated with them. For example, this request header country, maybe according to your rules, it doesn't have to be there. By default, if you say at request header, it has to be there. If you say at request header required equals false, the rules change a little. Dispatcher servlet is going to invoke that method. If the header is not resolvable, you're going to get a null value. And you have to deal with that, right? That's the reason why you have to say required equals false. Your code may not be prepared to handle that as a null value, so you need to explicitly flag it as such. That's what you traditionally have to do on Java 8. There's a variant of this that's a nice twist. You can use the Java util optional type. If you redeclare the signature as optional of string, the optional semantics come with the type. So all of a sudden, it's not just the string, which doesn't really say whether it wants to be null or not. Optional of string explicitly says this one doesn't have to be there. That's part of the of why it's nice, right? There's a way to use a standard type to express optional characteristics. But even better than that, optional is a Java 8 type, and it has plenty of methods that are nice candidates for being used with lambda expressions. For example, there's an if-present method. You can take the incoming optional object, call the if-present method, specify a callback, typically as a lambda expression. So like, if it is present, that's what I want to do with the value. If not, that line is simply going to be skipped because you're calling if present, and if present ducks out if the value isn't there. There are quite a few methods on optional. So there are quite a few ways of associating lambda expressions with specific scenarios, if the value is there, not there, and so forth. It's a little bit functional. It goes into the direction of functional programming, but in a very mild way. So this is what we support in Spring 4.1. If you happen to declare some of your parameters in MVC handler methods and many other scenarios as optional, then we understand that, we detect that through reflection, and automatically provide an optional reference to your code. So Spring's going to manage the optional instance, going to create it for you and pass it in that way so that your code can operate against it like that. The optional instance itself is never going to be null, just its content, right? You can also simply ask the optional reference for its value, but kind of if you're doing that, you can just as well go with this strategy, right? The value of the Java util optional type is primarily in being able to treat that optional value through the through lambda expressions, through the if present calls and so forth. So that's really how it's meant to be used, not just as a wrapper for a value. Right. We have a similar case in the dependency injection world. Take this just standard case for a Spring managed component at auto-wired, flagged with required equals false means that even if the container does process your instance here, but it cannot find a notification service for you in this case, it's going to simply leave the field as null. Otherwise, it would actually complain. Standard dependency injection rules are, if you annotate it, it needs to be there. Your code expresses that it does need a notification service. Here it basically says, like, I want to know whether a notification service is there. I can live with it not being there. Required equals false is one way of indicating this. In the rest of your class, of course, you'll have to be defensive. You'll have to code defensively. So you'll have to check whether the notification service is not null. You can probably guess what's coming. On Java 8, you can declare this injection point as optional. You can say optional of notification service. The dependency injection container is going to understand that. It's going to inject an optional reference for you. You can say notification service further down in some method, notification service dot if present. This is my lambda expression that deals with the value if it's there. So it changes the way of handling null references, of handling not available references, unavailable references. So that's supported for handler method arguments, and it's also supported for dependency injection as of Spring Framework 4.1. It's a nice twist to how you can handle that in your code. This sort of stuff can have a lot of impact in how you structure code if it heavily deals with optional values. Right. And no need to specify required false here, because the optionality here, that optional characteristic comes in through the type. Right. Well, so much for the Java 8 coverage. While we're at it, I'd also like to cover add priority quickly. Priority is a, as mentioned before, a standard annotation from the JavaX annotation package. Not in JDK 8 for really no good reason, very likely to be in JDK 9 anyway. It's in the same package and the same, it comes from the same spec that also defines at post-construct, at pre-destroy, some of those common types, at resource. So it's actually reasonably straightforward to explain. What you can see here are two service types and an injection point. An injection point that takes a list. If you inject this at runtime, this injection point in some other class, right? It's anywhere in some other component. This is going to be processed as of Spring 4.0, only as of 4.0. It's going to find both of your service types and it's going to inject them according to their order. The order can be expressed through an implementation of the ordered interface, but for our purposes here, it's expressed through an at order annotation. So if the order value here is lower than here, that means the first entry here is going to be my service simple, and the second entry is going to be the other one, my other service simple. So they are implicitly going to be injected in their declared order for an injected list or for an injected array. There are two things that are new in 4.1 here. For a start, in 4.1, you can associate an order with a bean method in a configuration class, or even outside of a configuration class. Anyway, with an add bean method, you may also express an add order. If you're going to ask for a list of my service, there are a couple of my services defined through add bean methods. We're going to understand those orders, going to inject them in the right order. So the question was if there's a conflict with the orders. Technically, there cannot really be a conflict. It's a simple order comparator. If the order's the same, It's not an ID, right? It doesn't have to be unique. If the order is the same, there is any order of those same ordered classes will do. Just like if you sort a regular list or array with a comparator that happens to return null, right? Yeah, the original order is typically going to be preserved. They're not specifically ordered. The same rules apply here. So orders are just an indication. They have no uniqueness semantics at all. So Java X annotation priority. At priority is a kind of standard way to express order semantics for a start. So as of Spring Framework 4.1, that's what you can do. You can replace your at order definitions with at priority definitions. And in at the injection point, you ask again for my services. We're going to understand that they have at priority annotations. If at priority indicates the order accordingly, then we're going to inject them in the same order. My service simple first, my other service simple is going to be the second entry here. Now, there's one twist. And I'll have to introduce or refer to the primary concept for a moment. It's a little more subtle than what we just explained, because there's another characteristic that is related to this. It's the good old at primary, has been in there since Spring Framework 3. No orders here, no priorities either, but there's a primary flag. Primary is meant for a slightly different purpose, not injecting things by a list, but asking for a single reference. All we want is a single my service. If there are several ones like those two, which of the ones are we going to pick? If it's not resolvable, if there's no indication, this is going to fail. So you'll have to give a hint. One variant of giving a hint is at primary, saying this is the primary service. If in doubt, use this one. If you need a single one and you're not clear which of the matching ones, use this one. Right? So this injection point is going to see my service simple because of the primary flag. Now, where's the difference between order and primary? Order is meant for lists and arrays. It's just an ordering characteristic, no uniqueness, no primary semantics. So if you do this, again, orders, as we had in the previous example, but not injecting them into a list here, asking for a single my service reference, then the orders are not going to help you. So this is actually going to fail. It says, like, I don't know how to pick one of those two. They happen to be ordered, but that's basically irrelevant because orders are kind of a separate concern. Now, the little trick is, for a start, if you want both characteristics with standard Spring annotations, what you have to do is to add both. You have to declare the orders, and you have to add a primary annotation to the one that you want to be primary, which is kind of repeating what you said with the lowest order value. You could argue, right? But those are separate concerns. They are in Spring managed through separate annotations. They are detected in separate ways with very different semantics. But with at priority, the annotation is actually declared such that it's meant to have these primary characteristic with it. So with at priority, that's exactly what we're doing. Priority has order semantics, but when asking for a single reference, the object, the class with the lowest priority value is also going to be treated as the one with the primary role. So that's the slight difference between order and priority. Priority has primary semantics, and it's a standard annotation, right? So again, for the ability to declare Spring component types without too many Spring specific annotations in there, it may be a good enough reason to use that priority for a start. But this little twist with the primary role may be another reason to consider it. Right. And for completeness, since we are talking about the primary concern here, now at primary selecting between the matching references, you could, of course, express this with a qualifier as well. So just to get your mental picture right, there is no primary flag here, just a qualifier associated with one of the implementation types, and the injection point is asking for that specific qualifier. That's, of course, also resolvable, because we're matching by type, and then within the type matches, we're selecting by qualifier. So that's another way of expressing this, of course. And to end our little tour of injection twists here, as of Spring Framework 4, though, that's going back to the very beginning of the talk, you can also rely on complex generic types to have significance. So if your service implementations happen to declare an interface that with a type variable, a generic type variable, and they happen to implement it for a specific target type, it's a my service of entity, it's a my service of event. As of Spring Framework 4.0, and only as of Spring Framework 4.0, this generic type declaration has matching significance, has significance within the matching algorithm. So if you're asking for a my service of entity, that is sufficiently expressive. We're going to find several my service matches, but within the my service matches, we're going to look at the generic type variable declaration. We're going to find out that only this one is actually a match. It's an ability match, a type match. And we're going to select that one based on that generic type. There's no need to add a qualifier here. There's no need to add a primary flag here. No need to add a priority either, of course. So we're trying to be as smart as we can. What you specify is going to be an input to Spring's algorithms. Spring is going to try to interpret what you specified in the best possible way. If the type declarations themselves are expressive enough, that's of course the perfect solution. If that's not expressive enough, you can add additional annotations such as at primary, at priority, as we've seen before. So this is generic type resolution in Spring Framework 4.0, actually one of my favorite container features. It's a completely new type matching algorithm. It's a pretty fundamental change in the container as of 4.0, but a really nice one. Spring data repositories, anyone? There are plenty of such cases out there in the wild. It's really nice for those types to be properly and fully respected. And it's actually a type match. So again, for completeness, this is the typical case. But for completeness, it's a type, it's an ability match. If you happen to have a declaration that says my service question mark extends entity and maybe a sub my service for a sub entity type or that sort of thing, that is also assignable. We have a full type matching algorithm there. It's not a key, so the generic type structure is not a key in the Spring world. It's a basis for type comparisons. So you can also rely on that. You can also inject a list of my service of question mark extends entity. We're going to resolve that for you to the best possible degree. All right. Pardon? If it's like down here,
yeah.
If that's a raw type, that would be the typical case, like here, right? Even if my service has a type variable, but you're declaring it as a raw type here, then of course it has no significance, right? We can only match by primary type. We can only match as much as you specify those type variables. You can also say my service question mark. Same game. You're going to find all my services then, and one of them needs to be primary. So it's the rules are basically the same that the JDK compiler uses. So if it's assignable in the JDK compiler, it can be matched by Spring as well. If the JDK compiler gives you a warning because you're using raw types, it's also going to match as a fallback match. So our algorithm follows those compiler rules and has a fallback match scenario where a my service entity can also be injected into a raw my service declaration. On that basis, the JDK compiler would give you a warning, right? So it's not recommended, but it's accepted because the compiler accepts it as well. And also for backwards compatibility, because in Spring Framework 3, you could declare it like that, but Spring Framework 3 ignores that part. It simply ignores it. It is going to look for my services, and it's going to ignore the generic type match completely. Only as of Spring Framework 4, this part has significance. In Spring Framework 3, there's really no other way than to add qualifiers here. In terms of the values, so the question is one with the highest priority. There is no specific singling out of values here. It's just the lowest value, right? You could also choose to use integer min value and integer min value plus one. So there are no specific indications. You would typically start from one, but you don't have to. It's just integer spectrum, whatever is the lowest value in there. The same for at order. So it's not much different. Right. So much for the end of this little tour. If we've been covering quite a bit of Java 8 related stuff and a few related injection features here. So here, just as a summary, lambdas and method references is, of course, the most important feature. And I find it very helpful to understand the design of those features and the design impact of those features to see how they are going to be used in the wild and also to understand how Spring is using them. There's JSR-310 and JODA time as a kind of sibling of it for JDK 6 and 7 in particular. We've been talking about repeatable annotations, about parameter name discovery, and about the use of Java util optional. And as a kind of bonus, we've been talking about ordering the standard priority annotation and the generic type matching algorithm in Spring for the DAW. Any remaining questions? Last chance? Sure. It does not make a difference where those types are being declared. So you're wondering if my service impl is an XML declared bean? But it would. The bean, not like that. The XML bean definition format does not have attributes of the same kind, but it can evaluate the values associated with the classes that you declare. Right? You cannot externally specify those values yet. The only sources for order values and priority values are the ordered interface, the priority ordered interface, and the annotations. So there's no external attribute yet at this point. Yes, so that question was, would the generic type matches here also apply if those beans are defined through XML? Yes, absolutely. It does not matter where those types come from. They can also be declared as @bean methods. In the case of @bean methods, there's the nice little twists that @bean methods, like here, you could also specify the generic type here. You could say my service of event in the return type signature of the @bean method. We're even going to detect that when we're going to match against that. That may make sense if it's hard to define it within the implementation class itself, if it's an assigned type variable, or when you instantiate your implementation class. You can't put priority there because it's a standard annotation and it's only declared to be applicable to types, not to methods. So unfortunately not, for reasons outside of our control. With add order you can, because we just redeclared it to be applicable to methods. Add primary does also work here. Add primary can be used on @bean methods. Right, there's another question over there. So I'm not sure I fully understood the question. The values for @priority are? Well, it has, according to the annotation rules, it's declared as an int attribute, whatever the compiler accepts to as a value there, right? You can refer to constants if that's what you mean. You can refer to externally declared constants. You can try to calculate from constants, like some base order or base priority plus one or minus one, that all works. As far as the JDK compiler is a little restrictive in what it accepts as values for annotation attributes, but that's basically what you're constrained by. Constants are perfectly okay. For JODA time specifically? Okay, so in the JSR-310 case, We are Java 8 plus, of course, right? So we have to preserve an option for Java 6 or 7. So even just from that perspective, it's going to retain for a significant amount of time. The entire Spring Framework 4.x line, for sure. If I can translate the question onto, does it make sense to use Jota time on Java 8? Because that's basically our reasoning. Would we preserve it even if we were Java 8 plus? Good question. Probably not. There are no really strong reasons to use it on Java 8. The main reason would be you have a lot of existing code using Jota time. You happen to migrate the project onto Java 8 and you don't want to redo that part of the code base. That in itself may be a good enough reason, though, for us to preserve it even longer. Since we are generally very friendly towards such migration scenarios. But in such a scenario, we would deprecate the Jota time support. That would be, if there is going to be a Java 8 based version of Spring, that's probably what's going to happen, deprecated Jota time support. All right. If there are any further questions, please just approach me individually. That's perfectly fine now or later during this week. Thanks for your attention and enjoy the rest of the conference.